We're here at Bank Street College at the Irma Black and the Cook Prize Awards with the keynote speaker, Scott Magoon.
A big fan, by the way. Thanks for having me on.
Was it easier in 2016 being here to give the keynote or back in 2013 when you won for Big Mean Mike?
I think this year was a little bit easier. I had a good idea of what to expect. I had a real strong message, which is to go back and let's reread our old picture books and kind of recapture the magic in the old books that we enjoy and also discover something new in them. So I felt really strong about that message today. Huge honor to win 3 years ago as well. That was very exciting. I was nervous wreck, but such an honor and so thrilled to be back. So I guess this year was probably a little easier for me, yeah.
Right. In your keynote, you did say that we should reread some of our favorite picture books. And you had a few. You had Miss Nelson's Missing and Goodnight Moon. And so another favorite one that wasn't in the presentation.
Well, one of my favorite go-to picture books of all time is the Little Red Lighthouse and the Great Gray Bridge. Hildegard Swift and Lynn Ward. And I just love that book. I loved the scale of it. I love the illustrations of it. I love that something old is still useful in the face of something new, which is really what the theme of my talk was today, was let's find the value in those great old books and let's rediscover a little bit about ourselves each time we read the book anew.
Well, we have a few of your other books. Breathe and Chopsticks and The Nuts, Bedtime at the Nut House. But I'm sure there's one or two other books that are coming along.
Correct. I have a book this September with Adam Lehrhaupt called I Will Not Eat You by Paula Wiseman Books at Simon & Schuster. Great, funny, suspenseful story, really quick. Cave, creature in the cave, various animals come by the cave, to which a voice says, you know, go away, tiger, I'm not hungry, I will not eat you, until finally a small boy happens upon the cave. Hijinks ensue after that. Suspenseful, funny, witty, Adam Lehrhaupt at his best. I have another book this spring with Eric Litwin. It's the third book in our Nuts series called Keep On Rolling. Love this one. I think it's my favorite of the three. I really feel like everything's just come together having done two books with him already. Great story, great message about, you know, whatever happens, just keep on rolling. Great song. The art, I think, I really hit a new high for me personally. Can't wait for kids to read it.
I'm here with author and illustrator Ann Fatour Kennedy, whose book, Ragweed's Farm Dog Handbook, received an Irma Black honor here today at Bank Street. Congratulations.
Thank you, Rocco. I'm so pleased and excited and proud.
What was the most enjoyable thing about creating this book?
I think watching my own dog, Banjo, give me the information I needed to get into Ragweed's voice. Banjo has a strange, like most dogs, a strange kind of dog logic, and the way that he manipulates us to shape his own world fascinates me. He'll bring me socks if he wants to go for a walk. Because to him, if I put on socks and shoes, that means we're going out. So sometimes there's a row of socks in the hallway, which means, let's go for a walk, Mom.
In your remarks today, you mentioned your great-great-grandfather and your great-grandfather, who are both muralists in the Midwest. So did you, and they painted churches, murals and churches.
Well, let me correct myself. First of all, I was a little nervous and I misspoke. It is my great-grandfather and my grandfather who were both muralists.
The artistic bent runs in the family right up until 2016.
Oh, yes, and my father is a watercolorist. I have a sister who was an art teacher for many years, another sister who's an oil painter. I mean, it just, yeah, it's in our blood, and we drew as kids in front of the TV every night on scrap paper. So we just grew up scribbling.
And you have all those drawings still?
No, I wish, because they'd be worth millions now.
So congratulations.
Thank you so much, Rocco.
I'm here with Laurie Womack, author of Ada Byron Lovelace and The Thinking Machine. Suddenly there seems to be an interest in Ada Lovelace, because this is one of several books about Ada. This is the first one. There are a few others coming out. What type of research did you do for the book?
Well, luckily for me, Ada lived in the 1800s. And back in the 1800s, people wrote letters. So I have a collection of her letters. It was collected into a book. It's about this thick, you know, about 2 inches thick, 400 pages of her letters. And then, of course, I did secondary research, mm-hmm. but it really was her letters that gave the full essence of who Ada is.
Any gossip about her?
That's not in the book.
Well, let's put it this way. I am currently working on a young adult novel in verse about Ada, where I can put in all the information that you really don't want to put in a picture book. For someone who lived such a short period of time, she died in her 30s, she lived a full life doing things that we really don't want our children to be doing. Let's just put it that way.
Lord Byron was her father. And so would he be a topic for a children's book?
Writing about Lord Byron, you actually have the same problem as writing about Ada's life. Ada never lived with her, well, she lived with her father for 1 month only, and then mom took Ada to get her away from dad's bad influence. So, yeah, I actually do think Lord Byron would be a good topic, but again, for a picture book, you might want to concentrate on his wonderful poetry and maybe leave out some of the other aspects of his, you know, mad, bad, and dangerous to know Lord Byron.
Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
I'm here with Lisa Kahn Schnell, whose book, High Tide, Horseshoe Crabs, won a honor for the Cook Prize this year. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here.
And congratulations. Why horseshoe crabs?
As a child, my mom and I used to go to the beach a lot, and they were there, although I didn't really pay much attention to them. As an adult, I love to take long walks on the beach, and we happened to be at the beach one time when I saw them there and alive, and I was curious about them and just wanted to find more information, and couldn't really, at least in picture book form. So I thought maybe that was something I could do.
So many, many people consider horseshoe crabs almost a nuisance when they're walking on the beach.
Absolutely. That's one thing when I'm talking to kids, I talk about how they get stuck in your sandcastles and you step on them and they're kind of brittle and obnoxious. So and they're a little smelly too, especially the dead ones on the beach. But once I started doing some research, I discovered the fascinating animal that the horseshoe crabs are and also our connection to them. As humans, we actually really rely on horseshoe crabs.
So horseshoe crabs have had a bad rap, I guess.
I think they have, at least by people who only smell them, yeah.
So would you consider yourself a scientist?
I got my master's degree in botany, basically plant ecology, which I loved doing that, and I loved the things I was learning, but I wasn't wanting to sit at a computer and crunch statistics. I really just like to be out in the field and love learning about the different subjects that relate to science.
So we mentioned you're from Kutztown, and Mara Rockcliffe, the winner of the Cook Prize, also lives there. Did you guys know each other?
We absolutely know each other. Yep, we've been friends for quite a few years, and our children are best buddies, actually. So this has been a fun adventure, a different thing to sort of get to share with her. So yeah.
I noticed that you have a horseshoe crab pin. Now, is that something that you had to search high and low for?
I didn't have to search high and low for the pin, but the way you get the pin is if you're on the beach and you discover a horseshoe crab with a tag on it. If you show the cover of the book, you can see this horseshoe crab is tagged right here. And the number down at the bottom is the identification number for that particular horseshoe crab. There'll also be a number on the tag that you can call and report that number. And if you're giving the Fish and Wildlife Service some information, and in thanks for that, they'll send you a pin.
Any suggestions of some beaches where they may find a tagged horseshoe crab?
Well, I found this one at Slaughter Beach in Delaware. I found the horseshoe crab there. Here in New York, Plum Beach, Big Egg, I believe it was called, Manhattan Beach. There's a whole online system of information about where you can go to do spawning surveys, and those are obviously good places to look for horseshoe crabs and to look for the tags as well.
Well, with the summer coming up, I think that's a great little project for kids.
Yeah, this is a great time right now, mid-May through June. It starts as early as April, goes into July, depending on where you are. All up and down the East Coast, from Florida up to Maine, you can find horseshoe crabs, even though Delaware Bay is really their epicenter, but they're all up and down the coast. So keep looking.
I'm with Mara Rockcliffe, the winner of this year's Cook Prize for her book, Mesmerized, How Ben Franklin Solved a Mystery That Baffled All of France. In today's presentation, you said that you like to gossip about dead people.
I do, yes, especially famous people like Franklin.
You also mentioned that you had to take out so much interesting information when before the book actually went to the editor. So one or two of those really interesting facts or tidbits or gossip that did not make it into the book?
Well, one thing that didn't make it into the book was that before Dr. Mesmer came to Paris, he was hanging out in Vienna, and all the grown-ups there were very impressed with him, you know, just like they were in Paris. But he also met a 12-year-old boy who thought that he was kind of funny and ridiculous, and that boy was Mozart. And so when Mozart grew up, he actually kind of made fun of Dr. Mesmer in one of his comic operas.
The book, Mesmerized, is about Dr. Mesmer and Ben Franklin. But tell us exactly what the relationship was.
So Franklin was in Paris. He was trying to convince the king and queen, Louis and Marie Antoinette, to support the American Revolution. But he was very, very popular in Paris because he was a super world-famous scientist. When the queen and many other people in Paris got all excited about this guy, Dr. Mesmer, who claimed to have discovered a powerful invisible force, the king asked Franklin to head this commission to find out whether it really existed or not, because no one could tell.
Did he get paid for that?
In a manner of speaking, I think he already owed the king and queen, because at that point they had sent quite a bit of aid to America.
Right. So, you know, the Hamilton is such a popular musical. So do you think that there should be a new musical called Franklin?
Well, you can't go wrong with Franklin. I mean, this is the guy who wrote a scientific paper about farting just because he thought that scientists were taking themselves a little too seriously. So he's a very fun founding father.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.